Good evening, everybody. Hebrews chapter 6 is where we're going tonight. And when you have that, say, I see it. Okay. So this begins a little bit in the middle, but you'll catch up and understand. The 10th verse is where we're going to start. Wait a minute, let's see. Yeah, 10 is good. For God is not unjust. And King James will say God is not unrighteous, unjust. Remember, I think Sunday I asked you, do you think God is fair? And my response was what? You better hope not. Because fairness means equal across the board. And fair means to deliver to us just punishment. And he wasn't fair to do that. Aren't you glad? And yet, we know that God is just. And he's never unjust. So, here it says, for God is not unjust to forget. God is not unjust to forget. All right. So in the scripture, when it says, God says, I will remember your sins no more, does that mean he wipes his whole omniscience away and he just won't remember? He's blanked his whole mindset. We got a set yes and a lot of no's. Okay, the truth of the matter is, it means that God will not judicially act upon it, your sins anymore. You know, he would not render a judgment against you no more. It is no longer on the books awaiting judgment. I will remember it no more. I will not act upon it. And then likewise, he said, and it came to pass that God remembered this person. God remembered Noah. God remembered Hannah or something down that line. And that was in due season. That means a season has come for God to act upon that which is within his purpose or something that a person had done by faith. And so in due season, God acted upon it, or he will no longer ever act upon. It's not to be adjudicated anymore. And so that's what forget. And from the standpoint, God is always God. And he's never less than God. But he doesn't have to act upon anything where there's been a substitute or what the Bible calls a propitiation, an atoning sacrifice that meets the criteria of righteousness to be applied to the person in need. Did y'all catch all that? That was a mouthful. I'm talking in legal terms because there's a lawyer in the office, in the audience. Not really. So atoning sacrifice, propitiation, is the death of one who paid the price for the death that was due to someone else. Get it? You got it now? So he wasn't fair to render to us the death due to us, but instead, Jesus gave his life as a sacrifice that was proportionate to the crime committed against God. And therefore, it pleased the Lord to bruise him. And when he shall see the travail of his soul, then he will be satisfied. This crime has to be satisfied. It will not go unpunished. It is not that I'm passing this over because God is righteous. God is just. And so therefore this crime was not going to just be, look, I'll just tuck this one under the rug. No, 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 no. Someone had to pay the price. And you know the end of this story, that Christ, which has been preached for hundreds of years now, has paid the price for the sin of the world, not only the sin for the believer, but for the whole world. Therefore, he has offered himself to the whole world, but not all in the world has received him. He chose them, but they didn't choose him, not all the world. All right, now with that being said, we go on, for God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love. In other words, he's going to act upon this. He's going to reward this. He's not going to banish it or fail to act upon it. God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown towards his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. And we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end. The end of what? Say it again. End of time. Or suppose I depart before the end of time. To the end of who? Very good. And then those who take the baton running with me will continue on in their race. And if the time doesn't conclude for everyone, then another person or people will take the baton and keep running until the end of time. Everyone get that? Okay. Then it goes on to say, and we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end, that you do not, in your race, become sluggish. If you're running, you don't want to be sluggish. You ever felt sluggish? Yeah. I didn't. Sister said every day. Yeah, it's unique because why do of a person I have felt sluggish, like something is weighing me down a little bit physically, but nothing is on my shoulder. It's something that's happening physically in my body that as a result of lack of sleep. Confession time. Or improper eating. Instead of having a good, healthy breakfast, I had a heavyweight cinnamon bun with all the cream on it that sent me soaring for a little while, but in due season. I once soared and then I became sluggish. Everybody identify with that. Tell the truth in the name of the Lord that you have known someone. So in the King James, it would say, be not slothful, coming from the word of the animal that is a sloth. And most of you know that a sloth is an animal that spends most of his life hanging upside down. So his view of the world is not quite on the up and up. So he said, I want you to be like that. I want you to spend your life not being on the up and up, that you always have to see everything this way instead of the way it is. And while they, you know, they would say, why are these people floating on their head and when they're really walking on their feet? It's just perspective, y'all. And I know I'm not too far from some theories that people have. Right? Now, if you want a theory, you know, you don't have to go far. You can get one. And so most of his life is spent sleeping. Well, this is not what the Lord, of course, wants for us. And It goes on to say that you not do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Not just realize the promise, but inheritance leads to legacy. I just don't want to realizing something. Oh, that happened. But I found that that happening connected and opened the door for this to happen, which opened the door for this to happen, which opened the door for this to happen. But it began with my obedience to faith. What's the word? Oh, say it again. Obedience to faith, that God was faithful to connect the first open door to the last open door, that we may run our race in full strength even until our end or the end, okay? So there are those who have done this, so we are to imitate those. Remember that now, that's going to be important. What is, I say you want to imitate those. Say imitate. Now, what is an imitation? To act like him. Now, be honest here tonight. And I know you will because you're saved, sanctified, filled with the Spirit of the Lord, name written in heaven. I know that you're going to tell me the truth. Just raise your hand if you think if you are going to get a whole lot of money that you could imitate Pastor Ricks. Thank you, brother. Larry put up both of his hands. That if we had a comedy hour, could you imitate? And the award is going to go to who imitates Pastor Ricks the most. Now, let me see those hands again so I'll know what you've been thinking in private. All right, let's take this a little further. Sister Lois, you're looking like, where is he going with this? Did you raise your hand, Anthony? You did not. Okay. Micah, did you have your hand up? You did. Okay. So, Micah, let me begin with you. Could you tell me if you had to do this production, and what is one thing that you don't have to do it, by no means, but let's just say if you are using some mannerism or some verbiage, what would you use as your one of your lines or strong points? You don't know. So he doesn't know. That's funny. It is funny. He said, I don't know. That's pretty good. Anybody else want to join in that you would dare? Yeah, a lot of hands went up. Are you holding it back now? Okay, all right. I'm going to let you off the hook. My wife had her hand up, baby. If you were imitating me, what would you do or say? She would probably laugh like me. I can be on one end of the house laughing, and she's on the phone with someone else. She said, something's going on, because that he's down there, and he is laughing a belly laugh. And she knows when it gets like that, your stomach hurts. And so I say things like, oh. And so, because the laugh is so hard. Hey, baby girl, that's you. London, with your hand up. And all right, what would you do, Zion? You would say the lines I'm saying right now. That's brilliant. There you go. Okay, London. I didn't hear her. What did she say? You're going to preach like me. That's right, baby. That's right. Well, the point that I'm making that, believe it or not, I could imitate some of you. Jason. See, no need to try because Jason said, I'm not tall enough. See there? That's right. That's right. So I'm not going to say anything, Mike, but I probably could imitate you a little bit. Definitely could do Micah. Anthony, I could do you. Look, yeah. I have too much hair. Okay, I guess I'm going to go bald in that imitation skit. Yeah. So, anyway. And then what they're saying is imitating those who through faith and patience inherit the promise. It is not just faith, but faith and endurance too. That you are applying your faith and the end of your faith isn't realized yet, so you endure. Those who receive a word from the Lord that they may have faith in it and then endured to inherit the promise. Got it? Okay. So he goes on, he said, for when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely, blessing I will bless you and multiply, and I will multiply you. And so after he had what? Patiently did what? Endured. Guess what he did? He obtained the promise. And so we don't want you by any means to be naive concerning faith. That the moment I believe it, it's going to appear and you'll find yourself indicting God because he has not moved in the season that may be in line with your timing, but he's in his timing, and so that it can be said, and it came to pass in due season. That which was promised, that wasn't seen, but realized in the heart, that persuasion was in your heart that you had what you didn't see. Therefore, you'll see in just a moment, Hebrews says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. To have the title deed for the property before you walk on the property and take ownership. Okay? I will surely give you this land. That's what he said. He promised it through Moses. But there are some things they had to endure, and certainly some things that Moses had to endure, but it did come to pass. That's very important to understand the Christian principle, lest we find ourselves shallow in our faith and belief system versus mature and endure. Endurance is important. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, who endures conflict, knowing this, that the testing of your faith, produces endurance, patience, King James. But let patience have its perfect work, that the end result, that you'll be entire, complete, wanting nothing. Wow. That you conclude that I have everything in Christ. That in Christ, I have it all already. Even though I have not tangibly grasped all, I have the title deed to all. And the document was signed by Jesus. How about that now? Is this legal enough, sister? See, I know you're watching my ways. So that's what faith does. It gives us the title deed without you paying for it. It is a gift. But a testament is never in force until the death of the testator. Then those who are in the will get the distribution of what was promised in his will. Therefore, we have inherited measures of God's goodness. And even when we don't even complain, but why? Because we see it afar off. We know it in our inner man, in our spirit, that all of a sudden there's more to your life than just living 90 years, 85 years, 60 years. It's more to you. The significance of you as an individual in faith is more than time itself, even though the clock is ticking and we're all on the clock. Right? So I want to read 15 again. Abraham has this great promise from God. And when God promised it to Abraham, father of many nations and all of that, and I'm multiplying, I'm going to multiply you, and just all of this promise, he had it. He had it. But it wasn't realized until later. So he patiently endured. Anybody need a good lesson on patience? Endurance? Yeah. A little bit more. For men indeed swear by the greater. An oath for confirmation is for them an end of all dispute. Thus God determining to show more abundantly to the heirs of the promise the immutability of his counsel confirmed it with an oath that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold of the hope set before us. To lay hold even to eternal life. Lay hold to eternal life. That's what the Bible says. All right, with that being said, this has given us an example of all of us in a generation where endurance is not necessarily popular. Am I correct? That microwave faith, microwave life, microwave obtaining, microwave everything. In other words, I want it now. 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 I mean, when do you want it? Yesterday. And so then the preacher alters his message to preach a message of now. To appeal to the audience. I give you a message of now so that you can get an injection of sugar in your spiritual veins now so that you can walk out and then have to go home and deal that reality. So what do? Let's go to get another fix. But endurance combined with patience is not a quick fix. It is the enduring principle of the Word of God working in us where time is not the factor, but purpose is. Okay? Amen? How many of you got that? You understand that? How about you, Stacey? You get the, was that understandable? Okay, is it understandable? How old are you now? How did you get to 18, and why did your parents allow that? You're 18. Do y'all remember when she was this big? With days in front of her. And what is it that she needs? Preach it the way it ought to be preached. Somebody needs to preach that. Why am I on the mic? She needs patience and endurance that she may obtain what? the promise. And so I have grandchildren here and grandpastor children here. All of these where I'm grandpastor. I'm not trying to take away your grandpa, but yeah, every man only has one grandpastor. Hey. All right. So I make my own self that, so you had much nothing to do with that. But what is it? She said it. She needs faith and patience. Faith by hearing from God and patience for the due season. So she will take steps now as being led by the Spirit of the Lord, not walking by sight, but rather by what God says. Because if you are consistent with walking what he says, it won't get you tripped up with a challenging moment so that you would say he's not faithful. But he is faithful. He is not unjust. He is not unrighteous. The Lord is faithful. So if he says he's not unjust or unrighteous, not to forget, then he is righteous and just to remember. Amen. And many things he will remember you have forgotten. How he's going to bless you may be something that you forgot, but he remembered. That there are things and acts of faith that so pleased him, he held them dear, and in the appropriate time, I'm going to reach over here and use this, and I'm going to bless you now for a 6-year-old act of faith. Pat said, wow. And in the Greek, that means wow. And if you say it backwards, say it. What a class. Okay, now we're going to turn to a familiar passage of Scripture. And so I want you to look at it through this lens that we're talking about. This is the foundation footers and everything so we can build a building, okay? So let's go to familiar Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, for by it the elders obtain a good report or testimony. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. And let me give you a parenthetical insertion so that we will not fall prey to evolutionary deceptions, that we, by faith, believe that the worlds were framed by the word of God, okay? So that the things which are seen were not made of the things which are visible, which do appear. Then he goes on and he talks about people. And these people are like you people. Okay, so by faith, Abel offered God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. And what was the faith? It's the obedience to offer God what he required. Let's go down to verse 5. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death and was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must first believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Let's pause and talk about Enoch for a moment. By faith, Enoch was taken away. By faith, Enoch was taken away. Now, how was it that he was translated? that he moved from earth into heaven without dying. God told him. So did he know when it was going to happen? The Bible says by faith, Enoch walked with God. He walked with God. He agreed with God. That's what I love about King James, that he agreed with God. And two cannot walk together unless they agree. All right. Before he left, he had the testimony that he had pleased God. And in order to please God, you must do it by faith. It's impossible to please him without it. Then he goes to seventh verse. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear and prepared an ark. Can you imagine building a boat and it hadn't rained? But on the word of the Lord, he obeyed. This is speaking to the obedience, the action of faith, because God told him to do it. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob and the heirs of him of the same promise. For he waited or looked for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Isaac and Jacob was yet in his loins. They weren't born, and yet he moved based on what God had given him. Then we can go to, by faith, Sarah, and you know she obtained strength to receive and bear a child. Goes back to Abraham when he was tested. He offered Isaac in the 17th verse, believing that even though he was to slay the boy, if he did, God was able to raise him up, 19th verse. Go down to 22. By faith, Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departure of the children of Israel. You're going to come out of this land. And he gave instructions concerning his bones. 23, by faith, Moses was hidden, and when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents. Okay? It's the parents that have the faith here, because they did not fear the king's declaration. 24, by faith, when Moses became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, and he chose rather the affliction of his brothers. By faith, they passed through the Red Sea. 30th verse, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down because God told him what to do for them to fall. And then it goes on in 32, and it says, and what more shall I say, for the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophets who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions because there were lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to flight the armies of aliens. Women received their dead raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they may obtain a better resurrection. Still others had trial of mockings and scourgings, yes, of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, or sawn in two, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and dens and in caves of the earth. And all of these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart or without us. And so these people endured and did not obtain the ultimate promise, and we did. And what was that promise? Yes, the Lord himself. Now, what I want you to see here, at least what God wants us to see, we can go through this list and we can highlight these people. Regular people who are moving by faith, who are living by faith, who are responding by faith. And while I believe Paul is the writer of Hebrews, there could be some scholars that differ from that, but it has the flavor of a Paulian letter, just in the substance of it and how he conveys it. And I think he wanted to be clandestine in the writing so it would be more widely received, because he was not necessarily a liked person. So, we mentioned by faith, Abraham. This man lived a long time, but the Holy Spirit is bringing to remembrance, and let's just say this is Paul, to the writer, which again, I say, I believe that's Paul, that what that person did in their life, he's highlighting the significance of what was important to God. That all these hundreds of years they lived and their life is narrowed down to, by faith, she gained strength. It doesn't mean she didn't do other good things, but this thing is a testimony from the Lord concerning them. So these testimonies not only tell us what they did, it tells you what God remembered, what God is acting upon. That while they were doing it, they may not even knew that this was going to be the highlight of what would be said to them when they stand before God. Because we live by faith, not for brownie points in the moment, but because it's organically normal for us to obey God in the face of a challenge or in our life. But it shows you the range of what's so important to God, whether it's faith to bear a child or faith to raise a child. And when they saw that he was a proper child, they hid him. That was significant to God. That God said, don't be afraid. So they were not afraid of the king's command because God said, don't be. And God said, that's faith. Because when fear is staring you in the face and the word of the Lord says, fear not, your response pleases the Lord. God always helps us to have faith by giving us something to have faith in. And sometimes, many times, it's in a time of opposition, it's a time of challenge, it's a time of something that you didn't know is happening before. I'm not trying to tell you that calamity is necessary for you to have faith. I'm just simply telling you obedience. Listen, by faith, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. He gave God what he wanted, and Enoch didn't. There's no trauma here. There's obvious abundance here. But Enoch didn't want to ask his brother for a blood sacrifice, which means he had to do something in relationship to get an animal because that's what God wanted. But he decided, I'm just going to give him, here's some grain. Just take this. And God said, oh, no. You're not going to give me what you want to give me. You're going to give me what I require so that it can be by faith. I told someone a couple of times because they asked about offering and different things at church, and then I said it to other people too. I said, you know, our church is the easiest church in the world to give to and the easiest not to. Is that right? That it might be by faith, because that's what's important to God. The widow with the widow's mite, Jesus sat there and he observed her. She could have walked on by. When you see me walking in the church, walk on by. it's that data storage. So isn't it beautiful that God would do it that way? That he may breathe in the sacrifice that you offer him by faith and not by obligation or duress, that it might be by faith. Get that in your spirit. So that no one in any service in the house of the Lord should be badgered to offer without faith and that still be satisfactory with the see what I just said? And that still be satisfactory to those who will receive the offering. That we want you to give, and it doesn't matter if you give in faith or not. Believe it or not, I know what I'm talking about. Okay? So, everybody is giving opportunities in life that God can reward you with. But it will always require faith, and it will be here we are living all these years, and yet the significant points that will speak for you will be those that God was pleased in this moment, this opportunity he set up for you, that you might respond to him by faith and that he would be pleased. And let me tell you, it will come up again because he's not unfaithful to forget your labor of love that you've joined in with those who through faith and what? Patience endured. Because the journey involves endurance. If you're going to get on a long run, which I avoid by all costs, by all means, some people are built to run, or they have the discipline to run, and that's probably not everybody. Am I alone? Yeah. So if you see me running down the road at full gait, you know that the time of the Lord's appearance is at hand. Something has happened. But if you see me on the side of the road doing this, he said, okay, that's just Pastor. Yeah. I played basketball at an event. I think me and Micah was playing basketball together. And we brought the goal down. And we were playing with some of those young guys. And Pat was up there and some younger guys than Pat. And every now and then, I just let them go ahead, run past me, and I was right here. Because, see, my knees need attention, and my lungs, and my heart. Yeah. So I mentioned that I went down to Virginia because I had to remove a building, and there was a dear brother who had said he would take it down, and he knew what he was doing, but it was still work. Because he had just made the declaration, I'm going to do this for your mama. And then I said, well, man, you know, da-da-da-da-da. He said, listen, your mama is my mama. And so that kind of shut me down a little bit. But he was going to do this for her. And so I was there to help him. And there was a whole lot of loads we hauled out of there. And he picked up a hammer that he had brought because he knew what he was doing. And he hit that corner beam. Pow! And that boom, it buckled. I said, my goodness. So I got the notion that I was going to do the same thing. And I picked up that hammer, and he was just working and everything, and I picked it up because I didn't tell him I'm going to do it. I was going to go around to the back, and I did. I went to the back corner because you don't want to let them see you sweat. So I picked up the hammer. And then when I picked it up, it was like it wasn't going to move. Whoa, wait a minute. It's not this one hand stuff. And so I grabbed it and I went over there. And And the builder just looked like. So I put that hammer down, and I knew that I was not in my lane. And by the time we peeled back that roof and got those boards off, it was work. And he was the type of worker that he was going to clean up every little. I wanted him to go home so bad. And I remember walking into the bedroom in my mama's house, just whoom, and there I was. So I said, you know what, Rick, you're going to have to exercise a little bit and make yourself ready. You have to make yourself ready. And so it wasn't that I won't do it again, but I'm making myself ready because there's a lesson in it for me. I'm certainly not for you. That in case I would have to run to rescue you. You see that cape come out there? That I prepared myself to be able to have my heart rate increase and I still endure. Come on, I'm going to preach in real good, church. Now, some of you, that is easy peasy. And there was a season, it was probably easy peasy for me. Am I right? What'd you say? You'll imitate that. He's going to imitate that. But those who are given to it, I'm going to work this out. I've seen Micah work. I've seen the brothers work. And I observe their work. And one thing I noticed, whether it was Joe helping me out, or Micah helping me out, or Brian, or the brothers helping me out, they didn't quit. Anthony, they didn't quit. Justin, I asked Justin one time, no, he suggested, he said, I can help you plant those bushes. I said, well, you know, I got it. He said, no, you just let me know. I can help you. Okay, because to me, what is it planting shrubs? Until you have to dig them holes. And I saw Justin because I had two shovels, one for me to lean on, for one for him to work with. But he didn't quit. He dug those holes, or Jason sawed that wood, and things that the saints, and I don't want to just go through all the names of those of you who blessed my life, and I've seen you in a non-quit mode that you were going to do. You took the job personal, and you did it. And I learned something out of that. And especially when you're dealing with someone who wants to do it with excellence. Because that's their lane. They can do this. And so I thank God. Do you not know before I could get those shrubs in, and which are, let's see, what's the name of those? They're called red berry holly. Anybody ever seen that? They have red berries on them in the winter. And they have a shiny holly, and they grow up, and they become kind of tall, and so it's becoming eventually a fence line. I asked God, I said, God, how in the world am I going to get those in the ground? Well, you know what? A prayer just like that. God made sure the right people were put in place to get the job done. Amen. And the right person to dig the hole, and I helped them put the bush in. Oh, I can help you with that. It's like Jesus said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. You think you're pulling the weight? You're just on a walk with him. He's carrying the weight because the yoke has two loops, one for Jesus, and there we are in the other one. And we're walking with him. Then he says, because the burden is easy. My burden is easy, or my burden is light. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. Yeah, easy for me when he's pulling all the weight. Just like, do you remember me lifting those ropes? Had it not been for the goodness of the Lord. So, we're talking about patience. We're talking about endurance. We're talking about faith. Those who through faith and endurance obtain the promises. Amen? Questions? Yes, miss. Yes. What was that? I didn't hear her. She said she loved her pawpaw's preaching by faith. And it came to pass that his granddaughter cried out with a testimony, I love your preaching, pawpaw. And for this cause she shall enter into heaven. And bless your heart, baby. Thank you so much. Any other questions? God will always give you significant moments that bring about significant reward. Amen. Please stand. Has anybody can recognize something God told you to do and you obeyed? Yes? Yes? Yes. That's the norm of Christian life. It's the norm. He will not forget it. You might forget it. I could forget it, but he won't. Significant moments that we have a faith response in become as sacred before the Lord. And it may not be highlighted that everyone knows. Some things you have determined and you have done in secret. Consistency, devotion, all those things that are precious to God. But it will lay on your record. It will present itself, and God will remind you of it and reward you accordingly. Amen? Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I love you and thank you for people to hear the word of the Lord and to walk, Lord God, this life in listening to you, making you number one priority, thanking you with a heart of thanksgiving, praising you, because of who you are and what and how you have performed beautiful things for our lives. Thank you, Lord God, today. Thank you for Jesus, who has made all of this possible. In Jesus' name, amen.